Disclaimer. First, this is going to be a very boring topic for most of you. I get it. If you don't want to watch it, that's fine. But for some of you that are looking for more information about spoke nipples and finding that it's pretty obscure and not much is available, then please listen on because you might find something interesting here. Also, I might not know what I'm talking about. I'm not a pro wheel builder. I'm not a physicist. I'm not an engineer. I'm just an average cyclist, amateur wheel builder who has an interest in this area and has done a bit of research on the internet. Lastly, for those of you that do have an interest in spoke nipples and wheel building in general, I think this video has to be made. And I'm going to tell you why in the next few minutes. So let's first start by reviewing the two major types of spoke nipples on the market today. You have brass nipples, or nickel-plated brass to be correct, and aluminum nipples, sometimes referred to as aluminum alloy nipples. Aluminum nipples are typically made of two different aluminum varieties. You have 2000 series aluminum, which has been around for years. Major criticism to it is that it's not terribly strong. And nowadays, the top manufacturers are using 7075 series aluminum, which is stronger than 2000 series, and some claim it may be stronger than brass. The main difference between brass and aluminum nipples that many people comment on is that brass can be 3 times heavier than aluminum, but aluminum nipples are roughly 3 times more expensive than brass. What frustrates me is that you'll constantly hear comments in the cycling community that brass nipples are only slightly heavier, but much stronger than aluminum, so you should go with brass. So the statement isn't wrong necessarily, but I think it's misleading. Brass nipples in the past have been the choice for obvious reasons. They were strong and there really wasn't any alternative. But today the situation is different. So knowing what specific material is used in your aluminum nipples is really important. Is it 2000 series aluminum, 7075, or some other variety? And what are the strength properties of those? Aluminum nipples are often criticized for being very prone to rusting, which is true, but nowadays a lot of the manufacturers use anodization to create a protective film over the nipples, and they're definitely much more robust and more resistant to rusting than in the past. Also, how the aluminum is treated is important. A lot of the top manufacturers are using what's called a T6 heat treatment process to increase the strength of the nipples. And it's claimed that going through this process will increase the material strength of the nipple by anywhere from 30 to 35%. But most importantly, saying that brass nipples are stronger than aluminum, so go with brass, doesn't even consider what I think is the most important component, which is the quality of the wheel build itself. How the wheel is built will have a major influence on the overall strength and stability of that wheel set. So the process of building a wheel can be broken down into 4 major components that affect the overall strength and durability of that wheel. First, assembly, and this refers to how the spoke is connected from the hub to the rim. This is often referred to as the lacing pattern. Also for assembly, I would refer to the process in which a wheel is de-stressed or stress relieved. So let's look at 3 of the most common lacing patterns that are in use today. So the first is the zero cross or the radial lacing pattern. In this situation, each spoke radiates from the hub to the rim without crossing any adjacent spokes, such as the name. And while this kind of lacing pattern looks kind of funky and a lot of people like the look, it doesn't offer a lot of strength, particularly with respect to handling torque forces. Next, you have the two cross lacing pattern. And this is where each spoke crosses an adjacent spoke at 2 locations, hence the name two cross. And while two cross does offer greater strength than radial, it doesn't offer all the benefits of other lacing patterns. The third type is the three cross, which is similar to the two cross, except it crosses adjacent spokes at 3 locations. Three cross is probably the most common lacing pattern you'll see today, and for good reason. A wheel built this way is both light and yet has a lot of strength. The second component is dishing, and this refers to the extent to which the rim is centered over the center part of the wheel hub. Dishing is important so that the wheel fits nicely into the frame of the bike and for overall ride quality as well. The third component is rounding and truing, making sure that the lateral and radial deviation in the wheel is kept to as small amount as possible. The fourth component is tensioning, First, making sure that each spoke is tensioned to within the specifications as determined by the wheel manufacturer. And in most cases, that's somewhere between 110 kilograms of force to 130 kilograms of force. It's also really important to make sure that the tension difference between spokes on the same side of the wheel is kept as equal as possible. This last one, tensioning, is what most pro wheel builders focus on the most. Unfortunately, there's so many videos and reviews out there where all they talk about is lateral deviation in wheels and trying to minimize that as much as possible. Others have calculated that during the rotation of a wheel, the spoke at the top is carrying 40% of the load, with the remaining 60% distributed among adjacent spokes. And those spokes at the bottom have decreased tension. So just focusing on this one point, one can understand why spokes that aren't tensioned correctly or spokes that are over-tensioned or under-tensioned could fatigue more quickly over time than that wheel built with the forces being distributed evenly amongst all the spokes. Spokes that are tensioned correctly are less likely to be overstressed. And if they're not overstressed, they're also less likely to exceed their fatigue limit. Once spokes or nipples exceed their fatigue limit, the metal is compromised to the point that it's being weakened. And over time, that weakening of the metal will lead to failure. I've developed my own spoke variance spreadsheet to track both the overall tension in the wheel as well as the deviation in tension between spokes. The norm in the industry is that any deviation in spoke tension below 20% is acceptable, although many pro wheel builders try to obtain tensions below 10%. You can see in this case, I was able to achieve a deviation in spoke tension of under 5%, which is very tight, while still maintaining acceptable tolerances for lateral deviation, radial deviation, and dishing. I think I undercharged my buddy Ben for this wheel build. So, in conclusion, these are my thoughts. First, when considering whether or not a spoke nipple will fail, or any other wheel component for that matter, you have to give consideration to the wheel building process and understand that that process itself has as much to do, if not more, to the overall strength and durability of that wheel than the quality of the components. So, if you buy into the first point, then I don't think the question is whether or not brass nipples are stronger than aluminum nipples. I think the real question is whether or not the aluminum nipples that you buy are strong enough for the job. And to that, I say that aluminum nipples, good quality aluminum nipples, are strong enough to produce a really well-built wheel. So that's my opinion on the very controversial brass versus aluminum spoke nipple debate. Let me know what you think in the comments below. If you like this video, please give me a thumbs up. If you're not a subscriber to the channel, please subscribe so I can continue to make content for all of you. Until next time, happy rolling, everyone.